Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. This message today, Bodybuilding for Christ, I shared with everybody the other night. I was out on the treadmill the other day and I looked at one of my boxes. I get a lot of vitamins from them because they're so cheap. So, well, it's, you save 60% less than in a store. God says use wisdom. I go in a store and spend 60% more than I go online and get it delivered to my front door the next day. So, just saying, that's wisdom. But the bodybuilding we're going to talk about today is a little bit different. You know, because bodybuilding teaches you to live in your own strength. Bodybuilding teaches you to take all these supplements and how many hours a week you got to work out and everything else. We're going to talk about a different kind of bodybuilding that has nothing to do with you doing it. It has to do with the Spirit of God in you. Because if you're relying on your strength to become a better man or woman of God, if you're living through your own efforts to be a better man or woman of God, you will surely fail miserably. And I mean miserably. You'll be frustrated, which is just pride, because you had self-hope instead of God-hope. Amen?
Amen.
In John 4:30 it says, we must decrease. He must increase. If you really know what that means, it means you got to be emptied of yourself. In John 15 it talks about, in the King James, he said he's going to purge it, you.
Amen.
To purge it means be completely empty. Jesus completely emptied himself so you could be filled with him. So he took on your flesh. He took on human nature. Why? It was our only hope for him to do that. So you can't go to God with anything you can say to him and say, you don't understand, because yes, he does. He was tempted the same way you are, yet walked sinless and blameless, fulfilled all the requirements of the law so you can walk in the newness of life in the Holy Ghost as born-again people, filled with His Holy Spirit, washed in the blood that makes you worthy. Never see yourself as an unworthy vessel. You are a worthy vessel because He made you worthy to receive all that He is. Amen?
Amen.
In 2 Corinthians, Paul said, I boast in my weaknesses, for in there His strength is made manifest. If we're going to be bodybuilders for the kingdom of God, whom you are,
amen.
You're the body, amen? We'll get to that in a minute. Amen. But know this, if you don't do this through the Spirit, you will be carnal Christians. You will be weak, you will walk around discouraged and defeated with no joy. I don't live on my strength, I live on His. I don't live on my accomplishments, I live on His. He accomplished all that I'm ever going to be already. He's already accomplished my destiny for me. I'm just walking out what He did and wrote out. He wrote it in my book. I got a personal book. I've already got an autobiography in heaven.
Uh-huh.
And Jesus wrote it.
Thank you.
And all of you have the same book written out for your lives. It's already written out. And when you walk in the Spirit, it is then that your life will have that richness and the fullness. And then the joy becomes of the Lord's strength and not yours, because you've been emptied of you. The problem with the church is there's too much humanness in it. Oh.
That's the truth.
Yeah? There's too much flesh going on in the ministry instead of the Spirit taking you over like a river. How are you going to worship God if you're doing it in your natural man? God's sitting there, come back to me when you've died to yourself. Because it's not about your name or who you are, it's about who He is. Amen?
Amen.
That word bodybuilding, it actually means the act of or practice of exercising, lifting weights, running, etc., as to develop muscles in your body. Now, when I was out in the garage the other day, I was building muscles. But that's not my focus. Because I was prayed up for 2 or 3 hours first. I was in the Word. I was worshiping. And when I was on the treadmill and doing my little total gym stuff, little exercises to stay healthy, I had worship music on. So as I'm singing and worshiping and exercising the temple to keep it healthy, I am praying in tongues and worshiping the Lord Jesus Christ.
Hallelujah.
I'm quoting the Scriptures over me. Lord, Thy Word is healing me as I work out, because it's health to my flesh and strength to my bones. I thank You as I'm exercising. I put good nutrition in my body so You will keep me fresh and flourishing all the days of my life. This is a temple, and it's my decision to take care of it.
Amen.
Just like Yours.
Yes, sir.
So that's why when God, I tell people, don't dare go on a diet. It's the worst thing you can do, because now you put restrictions on God. Now you've made a man-made formula for taking care of the temple He made. He'll tell you what to put in there.
Amen.
He'll tell you how long you can exercise, because me, I get ahead of myself some days, like sharpening knives. So guess what? It didn't get chilly, don't worry about it. But guess what? He tells me what foods to eat, what foods to put in the blender. He tells us what to do, because he knows what's going to keep me fresh and flourishing. Now, can he do it without all that stuff? Of course, he's God. But we have to be disciplined saints. We have to exercise our faith every day so that we remain walking with Him. See, God did all the work. It's you believing it and embracing it and follow this. This is the blueprint. And He will tell you how to do it, what to eat, when to sleep, and everything else. And let me tell you something, it works.
Amen.
Amen.
I'm getting younger, I'm not getting older. I tell people that all the time. They think I'm crazy. Well, God bless them. That's why I feel so good at my age, and they don't.
That's the word.
God said so.
That's the word.
He made me a promise that I'm going to keep you fresh and flourishing. If He tarries, I'm going to make it to 120, because the book says, after the flood, I'm to live to 120. But it doesn't say I'm going to get old and crumble and be laying in a bed and die. I'm going to be like Abraham. I'm going to be producing fruit until I go home. I don't know about the rest of you, but He says I can. And if God says I can, I can. Because He'll equip me to do it. Amen?
Amen.
I'm going to throw you a warning first. 1 Timothy, 4th chapter. Now, Paul had just spoken to Timothy about the great apostasy, which if you see today in the church and around the world, it's already happening by the day.
Yes, yes.
People are falling away from holiness and righteousness and godliness and compromising God's word to tickle people's ears. Mm-hmm. Never please ask me to tickle your ear, because that's not my job. Because if I do that, God will find somebody else to replace me. He will. I was warned when I was a young Christian, I will raise you up for my glory only. And you will speak with the words I put in your mouth, or I will find someone that will. I have nothing else to live for but the Lord Jesus Christ. He alone do I pledge my allegiance to. He alone is the one that bought me with His blood. And that should be all your motto when you get up every day. I pledge my allegiance to you and doing your will. And what's pleasing in your sight, Father, through your Son, Jesus Christ. That should be the motive of your heart to get out of bed every day. Because if there's something else is an idol in your life and a god. Mm-hmm. Warning. In verses 6 through 8, 1 Timothy 4th chapter. Because he was warning them, instruct people, don't go there, because the falling away was already happening then.
Oh, yes.
People were falling away. Look at the book of Galatians sometime. You'll see how fast they got back into the flesh. They tried to bring the law back into everything. You can't add anything to that cross. If somebody brings something to you that they say is of God and it adds to what He did for you, rebuke them quick. Tell the devil, get behind you. Amen?
Amen.
If you instruct the brethren, that's all of us, in these things you would be a good minister of Jesus Christ, nourished in the words of faith and of good doctrine, which you have carefully followed, but reject profane or wise fables. Exercise yourself towards what? Godliness. For bodily exercise profits little, but godliness is profitable for all things, having promise of the life that now is and that which is to come. We must have balance in our lives. Too many Christians go way up, and then they come way down. This is not a roller coaster journey. He says, I'll make your crooked way straight. Why are you going around the corner all the time? Why are you going left and right when you should be going forward? We don't take deep. You hit bumps in the road because usually you're ahead of God. You want your time frame and not His. You're eternal creature. Stop thinking about days and weeks and times and months and years. Forget all that. Go day by day in your journey with Christ. Then you'll have the joy of the Lord leading you. Because you know what you got when you go day by day? You got contentment. That brings great godliness into your life. It says in the Word. Remember, see, the Word of faith, it nourishes. Look at that. If the minister of Jesus, it nourished in the words of faith. What is the words of faith but the living Word of God that's living and active, and every promise is yes and amen in Christ. Before I went in the garage the other day to work out and get some exercise, I nourished my spirit man first. See, I let the Word nourish me. I got up, I prayed, we worship in the mornings every day. My wife and I get up, first thing we do is we pray, we read the Word, we worship, she goes on the piano, we sing. We make sure we acknowledge Him first so that our thoughts are established. We commit each day to Him so our thoughts are established, like it says in Proverbs. Acknowledge God in all your ways, and He'll make you pass straight.
Amen.
So I got nourished in Christ first before I headed to the garage. My priorities are right, and that's why he blesses that time. Because he told me, he says, you need to do a little more of that because you've been doing too much of this. See, you got to balance because you got to still take time for the temple. You matter. Because if you don't take care of the temple, it's just not going to happen. I mean, like I said, God could supernaturally do that. He's God. You got the spirit of the eternal God living in you. You wouldn't have to do a thing. He could keep you awake for the next 60 years. You never need a minute's sleep because he doesn't sleep nor slumber. Psalm 121. He doesn't even take a nap. Don't know how he does that, but he doesn't even take a nap. I don't get a lot of sleep, but I do need some. Amen?
Amen.
Got to take care of that temple. But that's a warning. Don't get so caught up. When I was a young Christian and I was working out and I took up running and exercising, as I did more and more of that, boy, the body felt good. But I would leave work, run back to the house, stretch, go to the gym, get on that treadmill, and do six and a half miles every afternoon after work, 6 days a week. Started out a little bit, but that became my focus. Mm-hmm. Then I got married. Everybody said, all that weight you just lost last year and a half, you've never been married, you got some things to learn, that's coming back. No, it's not, never going to happen. I lied. Yes, it did. Because I had so focused my life, Jesus got put over here. He almost brought her, and we got married in the nick of time because I was so focused on that, I was going to start even doing more. Because 6.5-7 miles wasn't enough to run anymore. You do get a runner's high when you run. I heard about that but never knew it because I'd hit about the 4-4.5 mile mark, and I wouldn't remember the next 2 miles because you're just cruising. You're running at 6.5-7 miles an hour, and you're motoring. You're going. And it does, it takes you over. So he had to readjust my priorities. Now, before I go out to that gym and the treadmill in my garage, the first thing I do is I have prayed, I have worshipped, I have nourished my spirit man with the living word of God, which is health to my flesh and strength to my bones. So now he's balancing my life out a lot more. Is everything I do centered in Christ? Yes. As long as I do that, he'll keep me on that road, that highway of holiness. Amen?
Amen.
So don't neglect your body. But never neglect this. What Paul's saying is, this is first. This has got to be first. Your journey with Jesus takes preeminence over everything else in your life, or things start pulling you away from your journey. It's very easy to get distracted. Amen? Look at the world we live in. Everything's a distraction. I heard the greatest thing on one of the news clips this morning on my phone. I got done studying. The phone went beep, beep. It means a news clip. I looked at a couple of these headlines. Hollywood says they're going to quit being movie stars and everything if we keep going in the direction we're going as a country. And I said, thank you, Jesus. Those poor souls actually think their voice matters. What's a shame is none of them know Jesus. The end is coming for a lot of people, and they don't know Christ. But what's happening in America is we're being born again.
Yes.
God gave me that word a week ago. My wife and I, we were praying in the booth at Mom's last night, and this man got up to leave. I could see the words. You know me, I'm getting past my shyness, so it was a little loud. Not me. But he heard us talking about the Lord and all he's doing. He got up, but he knows the Lord, but I saw like a fear. He said, I hope that's true. I said, there's no hope. God said it. It is. God says America got reborn. The first lady said the Lord's Prayer yesterday when Trump opened up down there in Florida. The first lady got up and said, let us pray.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
Can you imagine what happened yesterday in the heavenlies? The trumpets went off. I was surprised we didn't have an earthquake from the north to the south pole. The first lady got up and said the Lord's Prayer. Keep praying, church, because we're arising and darkness must flee in Jesus' name.
Oh, yeah.
We are victorious. That's an answer to our prayers.
Amen.
When he announced her and she did that, I was sitting there because I'd just gotten home, put the TV on. I don't watch news in the afternoons. I've got to go finish a sermon. Put it on. He gets off the plane, walks up there with his wife, and he brings her to the microphone. And I just started crying. What a beautiful thing to see the First Lady of the United States of America, one nation under God. She said, let us pray, and recites the Lord's Prayer.
Amen.
What a beautiful day in America. Can you imagine how Jesus smiled on this country? Oh my God. What a glorious day when we have people in government that get up and exalt and magnify the holy name of Jesus. Hallowed be thy name, O God. Thy kingdom come. Thy will is going to be done in America. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Praise
to Jesus. Glory. Oh, it's going to get hot in here today. That's why I brought 2 bottles of water up here. It's going to be a whole day. Now that we talk about building and exercise and bodybuilding for Christ, there's only one way you can do it. You got to know who the bodybuilder is.
Yeah.
Oh. Psalm 127, verses 1 and 2. It is so powerful that we decrease and He increase. You will never live through the strength of God in you that created the whole universe. You will never tap into that when you do it through self-effort. Self-effort is pride.
Yes.
It's all it is. Just admit it. We've all been born with it. And it's the one thing God has the hardest root to get out of us. I know none of you are stubborn like me, amen? Well, especially John, but the rest of you. Psalm 127, 1 and 2. Unless the Lord builds the house, they labor in vain who build it. Unless the Lord guards the city, the watchman stays awake in vain. In vain, for you rise up early and sit up late to eat the bread of sorrows. Self-effort is going to lead to sorrows. Because God's not involved in your self-effort. Because now you haven't committed your works to the Lord, so your thoughts are established. That's why people walk around confused. They don't commit their days to God so they can think the way He thinks. Oh. How are you going to hear the plans for your life from heaven when you're doing it through your own efforts? God's not a God of confusion. He won't bring you sorrows. He took sorrows, it says in Isaiah 53 here. He bore your griefs. He bore your sorrows. Are you going to have sorrow in life? Is pain going to hit you? Sure it does. We lose people. I had to go to a memorial yesterday. Does it hurt? Were there a lot of people crying? Yes. But I was rejoicing because he was a good brother to me. We taught each other a lot. I know where that man of God is. And I know he's dancing. There are no more sorrows. There are no more tears. There are no more struggles. There is no more pain. He is dancing on streets of gold, swimming in the river of life. He's rejoicing in heaven. And I told a few people, I said, you know how you celebrate him? By serving Jesus. Because that's the only thing that man wanted. I worked with him every day. We led people to the Lord together. We studied the Word together every morning at 4 o'clock in the morning. My wife was there. And I'll tell you what. I know what his desire was. Not for a big function, but that everybody leave that building, go out and witness for Jesus. Because him and I did it every day together for years. What a man of God. That was his heart's desire, to see everybody know Christ, to walk with Christ, and to spread the kingdom of God. If he was watching, I don't know if you watch stuff from heaven, but he even went, hey, you know what? Stop all this. Sing some worship music, go have the food, and then go out and witness. Because I know him too well. I know his heart. Amen?
Amen. Amen.
Colossians 1, all things were created by, for, through, and consist in Christ. Remember, he created you, made you. He's the builder of who you are. If you do self-effort, there's so much self-centeredness, even in the church today, they got all these programs, how to become a better Christian. You know how you become a better Christian? Die to yourself.
Amen.
I'm just saying.
Amen.
He wants you to die today to you, so He can truly take you over.
Yes, Jesus.
He truly wants to take you over. I felt a transformation yesterday. I didn't know what it was. It was really troubling my heart. I said, what's going on? Because even at a memorial, I'm standing in the back because I got there just as it started. There were no seats left. And I went, Lord, what's going on? And Madame Guillaume's name came to me, and it was like, she said, to really be one with God, your old self has to be annihilated so you are pulled into Him. I literally felt my body being pulled yesterday, standing there during a memorial service. I could literally feel the transformation from what was to what He's making me into. Remember, you're always being molded into whose image is. And as He pushes Himself more into you, more of you leaves. And then the glory's left. So guess what? It's not that you're going to lose your personality, because you're not. You're not. He made you individually just the way you are. You're unique. You're special. just the way you are. Stop looking at the way other people are and see how God sees you so you can fulfill your destiny.
Amen.
This isn't about other people. This is about who you are in Christ.
Amen, amen.
Hebrews 3. I'm going to eat up so much more for days. Excuse me. Just verses 4 to 6. It's 3 through 1 through 6, but we're just going to do 4 to 6. He's talking about Moses. You have to have a foundation of who the builder is and who you are. Until you start seeing yourself as a temple, a building, a house for God to come live in, He can't fix you. He can't change you. Until you see yourself as an actual building, the workmanship of God's hand, Psalm 139. He formed your inward parts before the day on the earth in your mother's womb. He was in your mother's womb there making you. He already designed you before a day on the earth. That's why you're all so special. That's why the human race, when I look around, I like people watch. I see God's creative power, how everybody's so different. They got little different things about them. It's the neatest thing in the world to see how different we all are. That's the beauty of the bride of Christ. We're all different and uniquely made. You should see yourself as a unique individual. As a worthy one bought with the blood. Oh, hallelujah. Every house is built by someone, 4 to 6 in Hebrews 3. But he, Jesus, who built all things is God. Who built it? Who built you?
God.
God, amen. And Moses indeed was faithful in all his house as a servant for a testimony of those things which would be spoken of after. But Christ, as a son over his own house, whose house we are, if we hold fast the confidence and the rejoicing of hope firm to the end.
Amen.
Whose house are you today?
God.
Why aren't you giving him free will? What was that?
Amen.
Why haven't you really given him free will to transform you from the inside out? Because he cuts your stuff. You get comfortable in your own suit. Oh. Boy, it got quiet quick, didn't it?
Yeah.
We get comfortable in our own suit. Remember something, you're going to be formed and changed every day of your life. You only get the perfect suit when you get home.
Amen.
That's it.
Yep.
That's when you hit perfection. And then, like I said, we still fall down and sing, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Because I've been there. Everybody still sings, holy, holy, holy. Just like it said in Revelation. That's how we are for eternity, okay? Those times I've been up in heaven, everybody still worship Him. He is still above everybody else, even in heaven. And we still magnify and exalt Him forevermore. There's no end to the glory of God once we get there.
Amen.
Amen? But let Him perform surgery from the inside out in you so you're not here anymore. It's Him who lives and moves and has His being in you.
Amen.
That's where the strength of God can carry you. You know, if we really died to ourselves and quit looking at the world for hope, your whole life would change. The answers to this life, there's a song, I think Rich Mullins wrote that. The answers to this life are written in His scars. The answers to this life are written in His scars. The one who died. The one that took everything we should have went through and put it on Himself. Freely for us. Let Him have His way with you today so you can find out what bodybuilding is really all about. Amen?
Amen.
We're going to be bodybuilders for Christ Jesus Himself. We are going to help build the house of God. You're going to see what kind of house we should be as a ministry. Because it's so important you realize why you're here. It's so important that when you walk through a ministry door, whether it's here or another ministry on a Sunday morning, a Wednesday night, a Friday night, no matter what it is, you should come in with a mindset of, I'm here to build and further the kingdom of God because I'm a bodybuilder for Christ. You should see yourselves as that. Don't look at the pastors, don't look at the evangelists. They got shortcomings, okay? Don't say a word, dear. 1 Peter, 2nd chapter. We're just going to read verses 4 and 4 through 5 and verse 9. We got to see what kind of house every ministry should be. It's right here. See, God doesn't bring us rocket science. He brings us clarity. How simple it really is. What we're supposed to be. What the inside of the house of God, who this is His building, this is not a church, you're the church, but we come to a sanctuary to fellowship, to edify and build one another, and you're going to see what bodybuilding really means in the church and the importance of it, and why the a lot of ministries are so weak today. Because they don't come with an expectation of being part of something. They come just because they want. No, you should become because you want to be a part of the work of God through His Holy Spirit. Amen. For your destiny. Verses 4 and 5. Coming to Him as to a living stone, rejected indeed by men, but chosen by God and precious. You also as living stones. That's how He sees you. You know why Peter used that? Because the Jews would know what that meant. That meant the tribes of Israel, because that's what the priests wore on their breastplate. The stones of the tribes. Amen? That's how precious you are to God. You are being built up a what? A spiritual house. A holy priesthood to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. Whoa! A spiritual house. That's why the days we're in, I'm telling you, a ministry that isn't run by the Holy Spirit will just be an empty building. There'll be people in it, and there'll be dead people. They'll be breathing, they'll be eating, they'll be functioning. Because apart from the Holy Spirit, you really can't even do anything that's going to be pleasing to God. Because you're doing it through your human nature, which is nothing that can satisfy God. Only the Spirit in you who lives does godly things for godly purposes. Because everything done through your flesh that you feel good about is probably done so you feel good about it. We are to be led by the Spirit to do the works that He created for us. And every one of you has something in your heart that God's Spirit put there that He will accomplish through you. Stop looking at other people's walks. You are all, and you are all individually houses with the Spirit of God in you. But unless you let the Spirit of God in you, not by might, not by power, but by my what? Spirit, says the Lord of hosts, Zechariah 4:6. See, you are a spiritual house unto yourself. So when we come into a sanctuary, all of us have spiritual giftings to add. But it has to be through the Holy Spirit that you are built up and strengthened. But we come alongside one another to help build and strengthen one another. And if we don't come next to each other to build one another,
amen.
It doesn't work. We need each other. Plain and simple, we need each other.
Amen.
So many people stay at home, well, I don't need to go to no church building. They don't know who they are. They think they go to church. They don't know they are the church. When the church starts being alive and active in the Holy Ghost, a spiritual house of believers, then when we go, they'll meet the church. They'll meet Jesus. Last night, we're in Moms. We were just talking about all the goodness of God last night. Having Sunday, praying with the people there, and the man in the next booth heard every word we said. And when he got up, there's a man that knows the Lord, but yet I saw fear. Well, I just hope. I said, I don't have hope. I just know. If God said it, He's going to do it. God said, what I have begun, no one can reverse it. He gave me the word a week ago that America's being reborn. Yes. And then the first lady gets up and cites the Lord's Prayer for America.
Amen.
You talk about reestablishing this country as one nation under God. Forget Donald. The wife took care of it. They say she's a strong woman, and that showed yesterday. No wonder why I married that girl. Amen?
Amen.
But I could just see on her face how sincere she was, and the things they've said about her, yet she said, forgive them, Lord. The vile things that our news people say about people in America, oh, every one of their tongues is going to be condemned for their lies, because the Bible says so. And it's time you start praying that way. Mike told me today, CNN's going to be prosecuted for their stuff. They're going to try and take their license away to be on the air, and they should. Remember something, this country does not belong to the U.S. government.
Right.
It belongs to the kingdom of God. You are joint heirs of it. It's your nation to make it better in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Oh, hallelujah.
Amen.
We might get through this today. Wake up, church. We're going to have a Holy Ghost fire.
Oh,
thank you, Jesus. Verse 9, but you, all of you, are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood. You are royal children of God. See yourselves dressed that way. A holy nation. His own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of Him who called you out of darkness into His marvelous light. Jesus is the chief cornerstone of our foundation. Hebrews 12:28. You have an unshakable foundation. Amen? Unshakable. The rock cannot be shaken. He can't be shaken. He's God. When He walks amongst us, This earth is going to shake. I'm telling you something. It's shaking right now. You keep your eyes on Jesus because the devastation is here. I put on the phone last night and news flashes come up on my phone. And I saw one of those towns in Northern California is pretty much almost underwater. I-5 is closed in certain parts because it's underwater.
Wow.
El Cajon Pass, the whole right lane fell off.
What?
Going to California with a fire truck. Took it right down. I don't know how many feet it went down. They have to rebuild part of that freeway. It's shut down. There's one lane going to California. California.
Wow.
When God gives me a prophetic word that biblical proportions are coming and the worst rain is heading for California, Northern California right now, pray for them. And Father, we just lift up Northern California right now, all those people that are there, Lord. Lord, it isn't even the people, it's the leaders out there, the sins of the government in California that are bringing destruction. It is not you, because your heart is to seek and to save every lost soul. But we pray your grace, your protection, and your presence, and save as many souls as you can, O God. Let none perish without knowing you. In Jesus' name.
Yes,
amen.
Amen.
God is forever merciful, loving, and kind, and understanding. Like we taught in here one time in Isaiah, there's not climate change. It's the acceptance of sin all over the earth that brings the destruction of nature. It says it right in the Word. I wish I could get to our government, get on national TV and say, stop blaming the climate. It ain't got nothing to do with what's going on. It's your sins that you won't repent from that are bringing destruction on this earth. We need to go back to having godly sorrow again, amen? Because that brings true repentance. When you know you've offended God, your heart should hurt. And boy, when I fall short and I make a mistake, man, I know it because my heart hurts. You know what I do? I bow my head. Before I've lifted my head, you know what? He's already dealt with it. Father, all these sirens and fire engines and ambulances, like I said, I just cover this whole valley with the blood of Jesus and the protection of Jesus' mighty name over this whole great city of Quran. Amen.
Amen.
Bodybuilding for Christ is building and strengthening His body, the church, which you are. Amen.
Amen.
We're to be a spiritual powerhouse. The visions I get, it's like amazing. God's standing there waiting for you to rise up.
Yes.
He already rose on the third day.
Hello.
He already gave you resurrection power. He's already defeated the enemy. Mm-hmm. What are you waiting for? Why aren't you taking your authority by Jesus' side? Why aren't you approaching the Father and saying, I just thank you. This day I decree and declare a thing, and when I do, you'll establish it. It says so in the Word that our country is going to be so holy and so righteous. America is going to glow in the glory of God. But you know what happens during revival? People stop murdering. They stop hating. They start loving again. Spiritually, mentally, emotionally, physically, people are healed. Children, did you see Connor this morning? Did you see on his knees raising his hand to Jesus? He's been with us over 5 years, that young boy. He was here in diapers. And to see that today, I stood back there. I said, oh my God. You know what the Father said? He ain't seen nothing yet. But in revival, when the young ones see the adults worshiping and walking in holiness and godliness. And Father, I just thank you. Everybody that goes by the name of Christian, they raise their children in Christian ways. But the parents set the example for the children in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We need godly families again.
Lord.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Now, fear not, allow the sifting of the Lord. He kind of threw me a curveball yesterday because I was on a roll and the Holy Spirit's moving. He says, go to Luke 22. I knew where he was going because he said so. Remember what I said about the purging part? This reminded me, we had a brother here years ago that God gave a vision about a child's sandbox with screens. And he turned me to this yesterday. And this is for the church. This is how serious it is. Verses 31 and 32 in Luke 22. And the Lord said, Simon, Simon, indeed Satan has asked for you, that he may sift you as wheat. But I have prayed for you that your faith should not fail. And when? Because he already knew he was going to fall. He already knew. Because the next couple sentences, when you read it, you'll see that. when you have returned to me, do what? Strengthen your brethren. Galatians 2:20, I've been crucified with Christ. John 15, he purges us. This vision that Brother Art had, God showed him the church. And the screen, so, you know, you sift sand, make it thinner and thinner. Well, he pulled it up through the church. What was left went to the next screen. Then God's hands pulled that up through the church. What was left falled into the third one. And as he pulled up the third one, what was left was the remnant.
Wow. All right, Jesus.
The sifting you've been going through, praise Jesus for it, Kareem. You went through some of it Friday. When you walk with God, and you know who you are, Junior gets his little tails and his little feathers, his little horns come up. He doesn't like that. Because the closer you get to Jesus, the more effective you are. The more power starts to emanate out of you. The more you change lives around you. We are to be a beacon of the living Word, which is the light of truth. The light of God's glory should be emanating out of us as a church. That's why you're going through a sifting. So your life becomes never about you again. Ever. It becomes all about Him. We are not here for us. You are here for the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. You are here to bring Him glory and only one that's worthy of it. Because He alone is perfect and holy and true and just. We have imperfections. I mean, well, John doesn't, but the rest of us. So I'm just saying. But think about what God's doing. When I saw that sifting, He reminded me of that vision He gave him, and it was so powerful. God just brought that back to me yesterday and today. He says, explain what sifting is. It's me purifying you, and then purifying you, and then purifying you. And what's left is that pure gold.
Oh, geez.
Remember how they purify gold? They do it so many times until it's a mirror. You are to be a reflection of the living God.
Ooh, Jesus.
Ooh, go through the sifting and embrace it today. Lord. Think about that. When people meet you, they're meeting Jesus.
Yes.
They should be. What's your conversation when you go out in public? Ours was Jesus last night. He gave a man hope when he left last night. He was still kind of shaken up because he listens to too much news, I'm sure.
Oh, yeah.
You know, if you watch too much news and you listen to it, you will think like it, you will talk like it, you will probably believe it. That's even scarier. I listen to the news enough to where I get enough out of it, and then I usually get insight from it. Go pray for this, go pray for that. But more than about 5 minutes, every more it just turns my stomach and it grieves me because I can't believe how far humanity has fallen. Their conscience, the Bible says, seared. With a hot iron.
Jesus.
But they don't know what's going to be hot here quickly. Let me tell you something. The cleansing of this planet is coming. Oh. And it's coming in the form of Holy Ghost fire. It's a kingdom that not can be shaken. The Bible says in Hebrews, it's a terrible thing to fall into the hands of an angry God. Oh. And they're about to, because God's angry right now.
Yes, He is.
Because people aren't getting it. They're still doing things. These disasters are not just here in America, but all over the earth. Plagues, pestilence, wars. The abominations that people are doing are just so disgusting. And like I said something the other day, it's Sodom and Gomorrah in the days of Noah, folks.
Yes.
Everybody goes, well, God will accept me. No, He won't. He don't accept sin. Sin can't enter heaven.
Amen.
It's holy there. It's a holy city.
Hallelujah.
Death. And we need to start telling people, no, you can go do what you want. You can go break those Ten Commandments. But let me tell you something. There's a God of justice that's going to come calling into account. Not me.
Uh-huh.
I tell people this. Well, I said, I'm not judging you. I'm just telling you what I believe because I know it's true. I know when I stumble and bang my head, there's a correction coming. I know it and I deserve it because a father corrects his child. And when I learned to praise God for the corrections, you know what I got during those corrections? Was wisdom not to make that turn again. He never cast me away. He never stopped loving me. And He never judged me. He corrected me because He loves me. So when you get correction, a lot of times that's part of your sifting because you've been in yourself so much, you think you're accomplishing something in this world. Apart from Christ, the Bible says, are filthy rags your works. Just saying. So let the sifting happen, amen? He's purifying your hearts and your minds so that you are spotless and holy before our King. You're His bride. Live as such. Members of, you're holy. You don't let anything touch you that's going to defile you. Not your thinking, not your eyes, not your mind, nothing. Remember, you're a holy temple, a holy priesthood. That's who you are. And when Peter wrote that, the Jews must have went crazy. What do you mean everybody's now a priest and a king? Because they had priests up here. They had all the priests. They were, they're the holy people. No, they were the most unholy because Jesus rebuked them all as being hypocrites and murderers and adulterers and liars. He said it, not me. He's allowed to say those things. But never judge a soul by what they're doing, because you were once the same. The Bible says we're barely saved, but by the grace, therefore, we go. Amen?
Amen.
2 Timothy, 4th chapter. Because once you've been sifted, then the joy of the Lord can be your strength, because you're no longer in your power. You have a new source of power, and it's the Holy Ghost. Everything in your life has to be done by the Spirit. Because if it's done by you, God didn't lead you to it. He's not going to go lead you to do stuff that He didn't predetermine for you before the foundation of the earth. See, when you're struggling out there doing stuff, stop what you're doing. Why are you doing it if you've lost your peace? He's the Prince of Peace. He's going to lead you in peace. When you start striving and stuff, stop! This journey with Christ is not a struggle. The struggle you have is with your flesh, because He's purging it. He's putting you to death. I'm just saying. I remember I went to my first pastor years later. I says, why didn't you tell me the morning I got saved to drop dead? You didn't tell me that part. You told me how good life was about to be. Which it was. But after walking with the Lord for a while, and I realized how still alive I really was, that human side was starting to come up. I went, that thing ugly. Guess what, though? He says you couldn't have handled it then, but you can handle it now.
Amen.
So it is a process of death of self. It's a continual daily journey. Allow the sifting of the Holy Spirit to have His way. When you truly submit to the Holy Ghost, let me tell you something, you're going to be so free. We should be so free, yes, as children of God, our feet don't even hit the ground.
Oh, hallelujah.
You shouldn't even feel your feet on the ground some days. You know that?
Jesus.
Because when you're walking in the Spirit, what are you seeking? The things that are above, not the things in the earth. You'll have plenty of things if that's your heart's desire, but make your bodybuilding for Christ's glory and not for yours. Because we're here to build each other, to edify one another, to strengthen one another. Amen?
Amen.
2 Timothy 4, 17 and 18. But the Lord stood with me. Don't ever think you're alone in this journey. Because He's in you. He's sitting next to you in the chair. He's here. He's omnipresent. He's everywhere. And look what Paul said. And strengthened me, so that the message might be preached fully through me. See, the message of the gospel of truth is going to be preached through you. You don't even do the preaching. You're just a mouthpiece that the Spirit uses.
Glory.
So don't take any credit. Amen?
Amen.
That the Gentiles might hear. Also I was delivered out of the mouth of the lion, and the Lord will deliver me from every evil work. What a promise from God.
Hallelujah.
And preserve me for His heavenly kingdom. To Him be glory forever and ever. Amen. When I read that, from every evil work, what does it say in 2 Thessalonians 3:3? He is faithful. He'll establish you and keep you from the evil one. See, God promises to be with you always till the end. To strengthen you. To keep you from the mouth of the lion. To keep you from all evil. To guard you going out and coming in. But until you see yourself as His temple, your house that He purchased with His blood, sealed with the Holy Spirit, you're not going to be here to build anything other than yourself. I don't come in here to build me up. I'm here for God's Spirit to live through me to build you. But I get my strength home studying for what He's going to give you. See, because He's aligned my heart with His. I'm here to help people have a deeper walk with Christ. I'm here to build up your most holy faith. I'm here to be a messenger from heaven to help edify and build and strengthen you. And you know what? We all have the same calling. Stop looking at pulpits. Stop looking at the TV, because you're just as important as anybody else. Every one of you is ordained by God, sealed with His Holy Spirit, to be a messenger of the kingdom of God to the ends of the earth. Every one of you is valuable. Amen. You should be. That should make your heart happy today. Because you are just as valuable. Even Billy Graham. I told you a year and a half ago, God brought him to me in a dream. I sat in the big church with him. He came and put his mantle on me. I've been carrying that burden for a year and a half. I'm trying to live up to that, and I can't. But God can.
Yeah.
It's been a burden. I've never been the same since that dream. I said, who am I that you bring him to me in a dream and put his mantle on me? Such a holy God.
Hallelujah.
God is so holy. Mm-hmm. And he had to do that for me. He has shown me that, but I have to see myself there for God to bring me there. Yeah. And lately, I've been going through some sifting so I could see myself as a prophet to the nations, as I was called in Jeremiah 1, 25 and a half years ago. He said, I'm going to make you a fortified wall of bronze. There'll be nothing that can stand against you. No country, no nations, no weapons will be near you. They won't touch you because I am making you a fortified wall of bronze for my name's sake and for nothing else. And you will speak the word of the Lord to the ends of the earth. You will fulfill your destiny because I am going to fulfill it in you. And it's hard. It's a hard separation because we feel so inadequate and so small when God shows us something so big. He's bigger than that. He's bigger than that. You've put such limitations on God when he can do with you because you're too busy looking at others. Stop looking at others, go home and look in the mirror and say, I am yours. Yes, you made this universe. I have the same power that when you said, let there be light, is in me. The same one who wrote this book, who sealed the new covenant in his own blood, is in you. God says, with God, all things are possible for you that believe.
Hallelujah.
Now stop your unbelief and start believing that you can go out and change the world. Hallelujah. And then God can do something with you. Amen. When you say, well, God, I can't do any of that. Well, that's good. Neither can I. I can't accomplish anything good without God. But I know with him and through him and by his strength and power, there's nothing impossible for me.
Yes.
Nothing. And I'm starting to actually believe it. Well, it's hard because it's a journey because we do put limitations because humans put limitations on us. You go to work in a company and you start working your way up the corporate ladder. Well, you're not going to go up there because that's only for them. I own all the corporations in the world because my daddy owns them and I'm a joint heir. They don't belong to them. They belong to God.
Amen.
So when you start seeing yourself as a success story the way God does, you will be a success. Stop trying to earn it. Stop trying to make yourself worthy. He made you worthy right there.
Jesus.
That blood that jar represents, it made you a worthy saint. It made you worthy. Get all that old thinking out of you of who you are, what the world told you you are, what your mother and father told you what you are, what your family, what your sisters, what your cousins, what other Christians have told you you are. You are a man and woman of God called to lead a victorious life. Stop the nonsense. Stop believing the lies of the devil. I don't care who told it to you. It was a lie. Because unless your father speaks it to you and it lines up with this word, don't believe it.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Because God can't lie. He's not a man. He says you are priests and kings in his kingdom. You sit far above the heavenlies with him, and everything is under your feet. You have dominion on this earth. Start living that way, and then you'll start building your brothers and sisters. What did he tell Peter?
Jesus.
When you come back to me, Peter, after you fall on your head, and you repent, and you come back, now go strengthen your brother. He went from a coward to the leader in Jerusalem. Just by getting filled with what?
The Holy Spirit.
Yeah. Power from on high. They went to Jerusalem and waited. See, and when they talk about Joel, these are the days of Joel. No, the days of Joel, part of that's true because the restoration time is now. The latter wine is going to be better than the former. It says, I say, ooh, I just got a picture of a good bottle of wine. Don't drink it anymore, but that's okay. But the thing is, he saved the best for last.
Yes.
Where in the last days the wine's going to be that much sweeter?
Yes.
Amen.
Jesus Lord. Yeah. Let him not get that seed of the Lord. You in here, stop settling for second best in your life. You need to start praying bigger, believing.
Yes, Lord.
God is ready, amen.
Amen.
You've been looking to yourself and you've been looking to man. You're all in the wrong direction. You ain't been sifted enough yet.
Amen.
Thank you. Hey, believe me, I wouldn't be preaching if I didn't live it. Remember, I told you something. You can't preach the word unless you've lived it. Unless you're in this book every day and you're letting God change it. Don't go out and tell people what scriptures mean unless you've lived it. You can share the gospel, you can share the message of salvation, but don't start giving dissertations unless you've been taught and you've lived it, you've walked it, you talk it, you breathe it, you eat it, you sleep it. Like I said, I don't go do anything anymore until I've spent some time with Him in the mornings. We just don't even do it anymore. Our first priority, He's changed our whole life so much, our first priority is get out of bed, come see me. Come see me. Because they're not going to take care of you, I am. I am God, I am faithful. I'm your provider, your healer, your protector. I'm your wisdom, I'm your discernment, I'm your strength. I am your everything, I am your all in all. And when you start seeking His kingdom and His righteousness first above all things, you'll have a life that's... People will be jealous of you, and they should be. Because you got a joy unspeakable walking with Almighty God. That's how much joy should be oozing out of you. That's how much we should have. If not, you got too much of you left. You got too many concerns, too many worries. How many times does it say, fear not, worry not here? Hundreds and hundreds of times. I am God, I got it. I made the universe. What's your little problems? Why are you focused on problems and not on me is what God's telling the church today. Amen?
Amen.
Oh, hallelujah. It's warming up in here. Ephesians 1. Oh, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
15 to 23. We're just going to go 22 to 23. I know everybody's getting hungry. We're almost there. Oh, God, you're so good. And He, God did, put all things under His feet and gave Him to be the head over all things, the church, which is His body. Hello? The fullness of Him who fills all in all. 1 Corinthians 3:9. For we are God's fellow workers. You are God's field. You are God's building. Does everybody have it clear now? You're the temple of God. You're His building. It just says He put everything already under your feet. You don't even got to put it under your feet. It's already there. Think about what God's done for you. He's already put the powers of darkness. He's already ripped His arms off. He's already put darkness under your feet. You already walk on the head of darkness. It's already down there. And it's the only way it's allowed up off the ground is if you give it permission. See, when we speak victory, when we speak triumph that God always leads us in, when we speak spiritual, mental, emotional, physical, financial health, which is the abundant life that Christ came to give you back. Think about all the wealth that Solomon had. It's trillions. You measured it by today's economy. It belongs to the church.
We got more than that.
Because all the wealth of the wicked, which they think is theirs, belongs to God, and it belongs being in the house of the righteous. And until the church starts believing it, why are we not feeding the world as a church? Because we don't believe Abraham's blessings are ours. Abraham had some stuff. Job got some stuff restored to him. We talked about that, what was that, Wednesday? He got back more than double. Double for the trouble, amen? And a lot of the prophetic voices out there, not getting, I haven't just gotten it, but I'm hearing it all over the place. Everybody's saying this is the year of restoration. God's going to give you back all that was taken. Do you know when God says, everybody will see you as the posterity the Lord has blessed? That's the generational stuff you got stolen. God's going to restore the stuff you don't even know you got coming. Oh. You got stuff coming you don't even know about. Because it got stolen through the family tree. And when you're right with God and you're sifted and that stuff doesn't matter, that's when stuff comes. That's when the breakthroughs come. When the things you're looking for don't become important. When Christ is what you seek every day.
Amen.
See, because then stuff comes with the blessing. I'm telling you, it's so important that we focus on our journey and edifying and building the church up so we are the glorious light to a dark world. Amen?
Amen. Yes,
bodybuilding for Christ. He gave me one word yesterday when I was closing up. Edification. The act of building is edification. It's the act of edifying. To edify is to build, construct a dwelling, a house, a temple. To instruct, especially to instruct or to improve morally, spiritually, to enlighten. Wow.
Now when we come to edify one another, that's bodybuilding for Christ. We're building up the church. We're building up each other. It comes down to one word. It's an action word. Because if you come in here just for you, now, should you all get fed every time we're together? Yes. Spiritually, whatever you need. But when you come in here looking to be a vessel of God edifying others through you, just think how the church would strengthen men and come together as a family of one. Think about what would happen if you came through this door, not for you, but for God's glory, to edify and to build and strengthen His church. Because if you come in here with needs other than spiritual needs, you're coming in the wrong place. Because the wants are already done. God says He'll supply all I need. I don't come in here with needs. I don't come in here with a need list. I come in here because God brings me here, and I have a desire to see all of us grow and mature in Christ and become more like Jesus every day. The other stuff comes with it. The blessings come with it. But our relationship with Christ must take preeminence. So when we come in here, Lord, who do I need to pray for today? Who do I need to give a word of encouragement? You know, one little word of encouragement can change a whole person's life.
Hallelujah.
I had a man on a bar stool tell me God loved me for the first time in my life. I was almost 36 years old. I'd never heard that in my whole life. Being raised in a church where I was never told that God loved me. And yet one man sat there and took a chance of telling somebody that was quite not mentally stable and quite violent that God loved me. And I wasn't in the best of condition right then to be telling that me too. So I was, but he told me God loved me. That did something to me. It changed the course of the rest of my life. Because he told me Jesus loved me, did not hate me. He told me Jesus was going to take me to heaven and not send me to hell. It changed the rest of my days. That man sitting on that bar stool putting his life at risk that day, and he knew it, took a chance because God told him, you tell this man what I tell you to tell him, and don't worry how he reacts. I wasn't a good person. I was the devil himself. And yet that man put his concerns aside, even the value of his life aside, knowing I wasn't going to react very well, looked me dead in the eyes this far away and said, Jesus loves you. He's going to save you and he's going to use you mightily. I won't say what I said because that man died. I can't thank God enough for that man and the bravery and his courage to stand up and do what Jesus told him to do. Because it altered the rest of my days. It put me on a path going towards Christ. I mean, it just changed everything that day. It took 10 months for them to pray me, 11 months to pray me into church. And once I got there, like I said, the rest is history. And now my future's in front of me because I have a hope and a future. God's come to prosper me and restore me and heal me and make me whole. And I'm still in the process. It's the greatest journey a man or woman could be on. There's nothing more exciting than living for Jesus Christ. Because I don't live for me anymore, I live for Him. Yes. And when you have that in your heart, you've been sifted.
Amen.
When you get up in the morning and your joy is being in love with Jesus above all else, you've been sifted. I'm going to read something out of Ephesians 4 and we'll be done. This is why edification should be in the center of your heart, because that's who Jesus is. He's the greatest edifier there is. He's the Prince of Peace, the Mighty Counselor, the Eternal Father. Stop going to people first for counsel. Go to Jesus.
Amen.
Who knows you better than He does? Jesus. He made you. You're His building. You're His structure. God doesn't make junk. You listen to the world too long. Don't watch your TV and think what they're important. Greatest thing about that thing I saw on the news this morning was Hollywood's going to find out just how unimportant they really are.
Hallelujah.
All the false news reporters, paper, magazines and papers, their subscription rates are down to nothing because everybody goes to the internet. And they're going to find out how unimportant they are. Being raised in a newspaper house, we'll leave that alone. And my dad worked with the New York Times a lot of years. And what he thought of the paper then, you know what he thought of the New York Times 50 years ago? It was good for training dogs not to go in the house. I was just leaving enough said. That's how liberal they were that far back, the New York Times. They were that bad. That was 50 years ago. Yeah, just saying. Paul said it was dumb. The knowledge of the world is dumb. So if Paul said it, I can say it. Amen?
Amen.
He said it first. You had him write it. We're just going to read 11 to 16. When you go home tonight, I want you to reread this from 7 to 16 and meditate on it. This is what edification is about. This is the house of God. You are the body of Christ. He is the head.
Yes.
Think about when they're building the house. They come in, they dig out the ground. People come in with their backhoes and everything. And they go way down, they build the foundation. Those guys come in. And then the concrete guys come in. Then the framers come in. Then the plumbing lines and the wires get run through the frame. Then the outside of the walls go up. Then the insulation goes in. Then the drywall goes in. Then all the other stuff starts coming. The painters come. The landscapers. Look how many parts of a house are being built. That's all of us. You got to see yourself as a part of the body and the purpose you have in building the house. A spiritual house. A powerhouse of signs, wonders, and miracles. Amen?
Amen.
I just got that picture of building a house. Thank you, Lord. Be good to me. 11 to 16. Now this is so important for you to let this sink in your heart. Because when we edify one another and we build one another, we encourage one another, it strengthens your brethren. Yeah. Everybody has fallen short of the glory of God. Well, not John, but the rest of us. Just saying, brother. Ain't putting no pressure on you. But just think about this. When we read this, think about this. Make this a personal letter to you. I was reading the Bible yesterday. He kept putting my name in certain scriptures. I'm like, he said, let it come alive in you. Let the Word come alive in you. That's what sifts us, the Word. That's what purifies and heals your soul. That's what takes out the old and puts in the new. Like I said, I was talking to Charlie the other day. I said, you know how God reprogrammed me from all the bad teaching I had when I was a kid? He pushed this in one side, and it pushed the junk out the other side. The Word purifies, amen, because the Word is holy. It's sharper than a two-edged sword. It cuts all that junk out of you and all the bad roots that God didn't plant. Amen?
Amen?
And he himself gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors, some teachers. For what? The equipping of the saints for the work of ministry. For the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come to the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man.
Wow.
To the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. You're being raised up to the fullness of Christ to walk in all his power and authority. Let him sift you today in Jesus' name. That we should no longer be children tossed to and fro, carried about with every wind of doctrine, by the trickery of men and the cunning craftiness of deceitful plotting. Boy, is there enough of that going around?
Yeah.
But speaking the truth in what?
Love.
Our greatest weapon against darkness. Love. Love never fails. Faith, hope, and love, but the greatest is love. Amen. That we may grow up in all things into him who is the head, Christ, from whom the whole body joined and knit together what every joint supplies, according to the effective working by which every part does its share. See, all of you have such a big part to play in the kingdom of God. All of us do. Causes growth of the body for the edifying of itself in love. Think about what God's telling us today. All of you were predestined to be a part of the body, doing what God's called you to do. So when we all come together, we're a spiritual dynamite powerhouse. The fivefold ministry won't work unless you all know you're called and chosen. So many ministries are not a fivefold ministry. Because people aren't allowed to be free to worship. Is it done in divine order? Yeah, you can't have people running around, jumping down on chairs, not knowing what they're talking about. Because you're going to get them. I've seen enough of them. But the thing is, when you put your name in that chapter, you're just as important. But remember something, the chief cornerstone is your real foundation. He's the head. He's your foundation. But in there, you're all knit together in the bond of love through him. It says in Colossians, he knits us together in the bond of love. So if you come in a ministry every Sunday and you're looking to edify, you're not coming for yourself anymore. You're coming because the Spirit brought you here to edify your brothers and sisters in Christ. You're coming to encourage, to strengthen, to lift up one another. And we really need to do more of that. And we really do. We need to make a focus. Lord, I'm not here for you. I'm here for you. I'm not here for me. I'm not going to a ministry Sunday, Wednesday, Friday, whenever we're together because I need something. I'm coming because you want to live through me. How's God going to manifest his life through you if it's all about you in this world. The most unselfish vessel was Jesus Christ. I got quiet at God. He set the example for us to follow. So when you allow Him to sift you, you'll find out all your concerns go away. Because you'll see how much He's in control. He can't be in control and sovereign Lord over your existence until you allow Him. If you're trying to please Him through human efforts and you got all your little rituals you're doing, He doesn't even acknowledge those. You know what He acknowledged? A broken and contrite heart. Psalm 51, read it. Because when we know, Lord, the only thing I can boast in is the blood of the cross which saved me. When you know that, and you walk humbly, what does it say? The Lord desires of you, but to love kindness, to do justly, walk humbly with your God. When you're doing those things, you know how little you are, but He sees you as a mighty warrior. He sees you as a priest and a king that He established with Himself to rule and to reign on the earth now. So many Christians got that wrong. I've said it in here before. I'm going to say it till you all get it. We rule and reign now, not when He comes back. Because that won't do you no good, because you're going to have on your heavenly suit, okay? This earthly thing will be done away with, praise God. But guess what? You can walk that way now. What are you waiting for? Somebody, I can't wait to get to heaven. It's going to be, why don't you have heaven now? We sit in it already. Why don't you think that way, live that way, speak that way? It won't happen in your life till you speak it, because God already spoke it for you. Amen?
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 Amen.
Amen.
It's all about love. God is so good.
All the time.
Yes, amen, bud, isn't He? You know what's amazing? There isn't a second goes by in this universe that God's not thinking about you. He's not madly in love with you. You need to stop judging yourself and just know that you're loved. And stop trying to earn it back. You can't make God love you. He loved you, it says, before the foundation of the earth. He loved you when you were yet sinners and He came and died for you. That's hard to imagine. I was pretty good at that stuff. I was told God, I said, I came up with some stuff. He said, I knew what you were going to do before you did it. Read the word. He knew the mistakes we were going to make, the sins you were going to commit before you did them. Psalm 139, and yet He loved you so much, He says, I'm going to come take care of all that. So you no longer walk under guilt and shame and condemnation and oppression and discouragement. So you can have my joy and my peace and my strength. He's come to set you free from yourselves. That's why He came. So you don't walk around like this anymore. We walk around like this. The Bible says we lift up holy hands. Don't ever not lift your hands up. You're holy. You're worthy. You're washed in His blood. You're righteous vessels. You're as righteous as Jesus Christ Himself before the Father right here, right now. If you've confessed all the sins in your life, you're as righteous as Jesus. Boy, that should make your heart happy. But your life has to be about Jesus. Because He came so you two could become one to fulfill the glorious purposes which God made for all of us before the foundation of the earth. This is a glorious day. Let the word of Christ dwell in your heart richly, like it says in Colossians, and come alive in you. Let the word sift you and purify anything that's in your thinking, in your heart, mind, and soul that God didn't plant there. Stop looking at your mistakes and start looking at the one who erased them with His blood. Stop looking back at what you've been through and everything else. It's washed in the blood. You should have no bitterness, no unforgiveness, no nothing towards any soul on this planet sitting here right now, right here. Because if you do, you need to give it to Jesus. I'm sorry, people do evil because they're evil, because evil has hurt them along the journey. People do stuff mainly because they're wounded and they've been hurt. Have mercy on them the way God had mercy on all of us. Amen. He's a merciful God. Oh, Heavenly Father. Lord, I lift up holy hands. And there's only one reason I can do that, because of the precious blood of Your Son, Jesus Christ, who over 2,000 years ago replaced me on that cross. God, you've forgiven me so much. And I know you've forgiven all in this house for all that they've done. For all who call upon your name will not only be saved, they will be forgiven. They will be eternally redeemed. So, Father, this day I thank you in Jesus' name that the sifting of the Holy Spirit purify each and every one of us. Because, Lord, you're the only one that knows us. You know us better than we know ourselves. You know all the hidden things inside of us that we don't even know are there. We humbly come before you, O God, knowing that there's no separation, because Jesus tore that veil in two when he said, "It is finished," that we can approach the throne of grace and mercy and peace and love and kindness, forgiveness, understanding, compassion, all those things that you are and so much more. There is none like you, O God. There is none with a pure love like you have for us, O God. But I thank you, Lord, that you're going to change us. So when we meet people, what they feel is the love you have for us flowing out of us to other people. Because love is what's going to bring healing and wholeness. Love is what knits us together and binds us together. So I thank you, Father, in Jesus' name, there's an outpouring of your love through the church. Let us come together to edify and build and strengthen and encourage one another. We're not here for ourselves. We are not self-centered people. We are Christ-centered people. For we are new creations in Christ Jesus this day. Lord, we thank you for the rest of this day. We thank you for the food that you've provided. We just pray a blessing upon it, that it nourish and strengthen every vessel here. Oh man, let him have his sifting way. You should be so filled with joy right now, because you're not, because you just happen to let God's love to pour into you and through you. Don't look around any people anymore. You look to God, and he will use you mightily for the purposes for which he's created you. In Jesus' name, amen. You will not win this wrestling match. Bow and turn from yourself. Turn your heart back to God, and he will heal and make you whole again. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Father. God is faithful. What he has promised, he will bring to pass. Stop trying to figure him out. You can't. You're wasting your energy. You're wasting your thought process. That's why you have confusion and not peace. He's far above the heavens and the earth. So are his ways and so are his thoughts. Surrender to his sovereignty over you today. And then his joy and his abounding grace and peace will come guard your hearts and minds. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Wow. Stop your efforts. Stop. I keep getting it. Stop that effort. You're going. You got to do. No. He told Peter, plain and simple, Peter, don't look around at other people. You come follow me. What he was telling Peter that day, go read it. It's in the last chapter of John. Come walk with me, Peter, and do my will. That's what he was saying. Mm-hmm. I'm the one you follow. I'm your role model. I'm the reason you're here. Now come follow me and do my will. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Amen.